Eh bien, nous démarrons. Donc, bonjour à tous pour ce séminaire de l'Institut d'astrophysique de Paris. Nous avons le plaisir aujourd'hui de recevoir à distance, virtuellement, et de recevoir tout de même Sébastien Charnot. Sébastien est
Bonjour.
professeur à l'Université de Paris. Il est chercheur à l'Institut de physique du Globe, à Paris également, affilié au laboratoire AIM au CEA. Sébastien est spécialiste de
Au
la.
CEA, en fait, je suis entièrement. Je suis à l'Université de Paris, Institut de physique du Globe. Voilà.
Si, c'est
Ça peu
noté.
importe.
Je t'en prie. Donc Sébastien est spécialiste de la physique des disques planétaires, protoplanétaires, circumplanétaires. Il travaille beaucoup également sur les anneaux, les satellites, sur la formation des planètes. Il est à la fois lié à des travaux en observation et en théorie, en modélisation, en utilisant la dynamique, la chimie de tous ces systèmes. Sébastien est impliqué également dans des missions d'exploration ou a été impliqué dans les missions d'exploration du système solaire, Cassini ou futur, Cassini, Hera, MMX, et également d'exoplanètes avec Khéops, dans lequel il est également impliqué. Et donc aujourd'hui, Sébastien, tu vas nous présenter un séminaire intitulé The Formation of Our Moon, a Debate Question, New Ideas on an Old Question, in English, please. Je t'en prie.
Alors, thank you very much for the introduction. So now I share my screen. Okay, it should work. So thank you very much for the invitation. I'm very honored to have the opportunity to present you a work, enfin, some work and to present you, I would say, ongoing debates on the origin of the moon. As you know, the moon is maybe the best known astrophysical object because it's so close to us, and it is the only object where human beings has walked apart from the Earth, of course. Even though its formation is still a mystery, there are a lot of big questions about its formation, and so today I'm going to try to present what are the debates and why I think we. There are still a lot of things to understand about the origin of the moon. And just to tell you, as astrophysicists, maybe you have noticed that there is a regain of interest to the moon. And today there are about 30 space missions programmed to go to the moon in the next 15 years. So there is a very strong interest to go back to the moon. And we will see why to some extent. Okay. So the work I'm going to present to you today is deals with the origin of the moon. And I will focus on the one big problem of our understanding in the devolatilization. I'm going to define this term. Okay. And of course, it will be my pleasure to present you not only a review, but also some works I have done myself with my colleagues. So here I have put names of my collaborators because I'm not the only one working in that in France by any measure. Okay, so to give you some numbers and to put the context. So next slide. Okay, does it work? Okay, it works. Okay, so this is a family portrait that has been taken by the Cassini mission. You see the Earth, you see the Moon. The Moon is about 1% of the Earth's mass. Okay, and its radius is less than 2,000 kilometers. And today, and it's an important number, it orbits at about 60 Earth radii. Okay, but this is today, and I will explain you that it has not always been like that. And the moon, like every natural satellite we know, is in synchronous orbit. So its rotation is equal to its revolution, and it is about 27 days. Okay, so why do I say that the moon orbit was not always like that? Simply because, as you know, there are tides that are exerted between the Earth and the moon. So the Earth exerts tides on the moon, but also by effect of back reaction, the moon exerts tidal forces on the Earth. And the moon orbits in 27 days, okay? So it is around the Earth. So it is beyond the synchronous orbit. The synchronous orbit of the Earth is only 42,000 kilometers. So it means that the moon orbits slower around the Earth than the Earth rotates on itself. It means that the moon gives a negative torque to the Earth. So it means that the Earth spins is always decreasing, okay? But by conservation of angular momentum, it implies that the moon's orbit is always expanding. And here there is a little equation about the expansion rate. I will not go too much into details here, but you have to know that this expansion of the moon orbit is regularly measured, and in France we are the specialist of that with the US. You may be aware that there is a laser ranging experiment that is running for 20 or 30 years on a plateau de Calerne in the south of France, where more or less every week they shoot laser beams to the moon surface, and that hit some mirrors that has been put on the moon surface by the Apollo mission. And there is also a Russian mirror that is still in use. And by computing the time of going back and forth of the light, you can compute the instantaneous distance of the moon. So it has been established that, in fact, the moon is going away pretty fast, in fact. The moon goes away at about 3.8 centimeters per year. So it is today, okay? And so it means that the Earth day increases by about 2 microseconds per year. So what it tells you is that if the moon is going away, if you pass the movie backward, you may imagine that in the past, the moon could have been much closer to the Earth. And if you compute that for 4 billion years, if you assume that the moon has formed more or less 4 billion years ago, maybe more even, you may imagine that when it's very possible that when the moon formed, in fact, it was very, very close to the Earth. And today it is suggested that the moon may have formed as close as 3 Earth radii compared to, I remind you that its current location today is 60 Earth radii. So maybe it has formed at only 3 Earth radii. And so by effect of conservation of angular momentum, we think that at this time, so when the moon and the Earth were young, the Earth day may be as short as only 4 hours, okay? So you have to understand that today's rotation of Earth is not at all an effect of formation, it's completely an effect of moon orbital expansion. So we do think that the moon formed very close to the Earth. Okay. And so this is a very simple dynamical argument to put the formation of the moon in context. Now, if you look at now the physical property of the moon, so you know that the moon has been extensively studied. We have a lot of data. We just remind what I think are the most meaningful for today. So the moon is much less dense than the Earth. It's about 3.3 grams per cubic centimeter compared to 5.5 grams for the Earth. What does it imply? In fact, the moon is very depleted in iron compared to the Earth. There is only very, very few iron in the moon compared to the Earth. And we know there is an iron core on the moon because there are some seismometers that has been deposited on the moon surface by Apollo mission, and the iron core of the moon has been detected. Okay. We know much more about the moon because the Apollo mission has brought back to Earth a very large amount of rocks, of lunar rocks. So about 400 kilograms of rocks have been brought back to Earth. So you have to understand that it is really a huge amount. For example, you know that today sample return missions are more and more frequent in the solar system. You have heard about the Hayabusa mission, for example. You have heard about the Osiris-Rex mission to asteroids. And in general, those missions, they try to bring back to Earth typically a few grams of material, okay? And the first Hayabusa mission brought back to Earth a few micrograms of dust, okay? So, and it must be compared to 400 kilograms of rocks that has been brought back to Earth by the different Apollo mission mostly in the 70s, of course. Okay, so here are some moon rocks, and what is very interesting is that, and it has implications for the moon formation, is that the study of those rocks has revealed a lot of different things. First, the dating of those rocks tells you, more or less, that the moon solidified typically, I would say, More or less about 100 million years after the formation of the sun. Okay. So it has solidified a little bit after the Earth first. The second thing that is very important is that most of the rocks that has been brought back to Earth are made of feldspar. It's a kind of silicated and magnesium minerals. And it has implication because it is called anorthosite. And anorthosite, so those minerals, they are known on Earth to have a very interesting properties. It is minerals that float at the surface of magma ocean. When you have a lava lake or a magma lake on the Earth, very rapidly, when the magma lake on the Earth cools down, when you have a volcano, for example, with a lava lake, you have small minerals that are less dense than the lava that go to the surface and make a kind of lid very rapidly on the surface. Okay, so you may have a solid lid on the lava, and the lava may be still liquid below this solid lid. And those minerals that go to the surface, that float at the surface, are called anorthosites. And most of the lunar rocks that have been brought back to Earth are of this type. They are anorthosite minerals. So it tells you that it is very possible that when the moon formed, it was fully covered by a large-scale magma ocean. And today, what we see on most of the moon surface, what we see is, I would say, those anorthositic crusts that may have formed first at the surface of the moon. Okay, so what does it tell you, and what have we understood? So first, it is very possible that those anorthosites have formed very rapidly, okay? Maybe in a few thousand years. Even though the full magma ocean itself, I would say the full magma ocean in its thickness, may have taken a few hundred million years to cool down. So we have this picture for the moment where you may have a magma ocean that may have survived for a few hundred million years, okay, but that has been maybe very rapidly covered by a kind of lid. And so it gives you some information about the context of the formation of the moon. Other thing, now let's move to the composition of the moon rocks. So the composition of the moon rocks, it is very interesting. It is very similar to Earth's mantle. If you take a moon rocks, it has a composition that is very, very close to a piece of mantle rock, of Earth mantle rocks. But not complete. If you look at really in the detail, you have some significant difference. In this graph, we have plotted the abundance of elements in moon rocks compared to Earth rocks. Okay. For several elements, as you see here. And those elements has been ordered in the following way. On the left, you have the most refractory elements, like strontium, okay? Refractory elements, it means an element that vaporizes at very high temperature, like 1,800 kelvins, okay? But on the right side of this scale, we have put the most volatile element. It is the elements that go away at much lower temperature. Okay, so those elements here are ordered by volatility. And what you see, it is very interesting, is that the moon rocks has exactly the same composition as the Earth for the refractory elements. Okay, whereas the moon rocks are very depleted compared to the Earth's mantle for the volatile elements. So this has been realized for long. Hein? So it tells you that, in fact, moon rocks really look like a piece of Earth's mantle that you have put in an oven, okay, and that has been devolatilized. And so clearly, there is a thermal effect, there is an effect of temperature. And now let's move to the isotopes. So isotopes really are my colleagues at IPGP Geochemists. They love isotopes. And for me, it took me quite a long to understand how it works. Okay. But we see other signs of devolatilization in isotopes. Okay. So in this slide, this is for refractory elements. Basically, what you think that for refractory elements, the isotopic signature is exactly the same as the Earth. Okay. But if you move to volatile elements, what you see is that the moon is systematically enriched in heavy isotopes. Alors, this can be also interpreted as an effect of a thermal effect, because when you have a piece of material, okay, and when you warm it, you put it at high temperature, so the material tends to volatilize, okay, and in general, the heaviest species they go away first. So it means that the remaining material is enriched in the heavier isotopes. And this is what you see for the moon. So all that tells you that you have very, very strong arguments to say that there was a hot moment that the moon formation context, the moon formed in a very hot environment, okay? But maybe not so hot, because why not so hot? It cannot form at 4,000 Kelvin or 5,000 Kelvins. Why? Because when you go to too high temperature, isotopes migrate and mix very efficiently, and you erase all isotopic signature. Okay. Whereas if you want to keep an isotopic fractionation, you have to devolatilize so that the lightest element go away. Okay. But it must be at quite low temperature, like 1,600 or 2,000 K. So all that tells you that maybe the moon formed in an environment around 2,000 Kelvin. Last, and then after, I will not bother you with isotopes, but this is a very important measurement. Okay, I will just finish with the isotope of oxygen. Why are the isotopes of oxygen so important? Alors, as you may know, oxygen has three isotopes, 16, 17, and 18. Okay. And there is a very thing very strange in the solar system that has been noticed since the 60s for the oxygen isotopes, is that if you look at all meteorites that we have on Earth, if you look at the solar wind, if you look at all extraterrestrial samples, all dust, solar winds, meteorites, whatever. What you see is that if you, sorry, where is my mouse? I have lost my mouse. Do you see my mouse? My mouse?
Yeah, yeah, just in the
yeah, okay, wonderful. Yeah. So here, this is the ratio of oxygen 17 to 16. And here it is the ratio of oxygen 18 to 16. And what is very interesting is that all samples we have from the solar system have a different ratio of oxygen isotopes. Okay. On this graph, you see, for example, the carbonaceous chondrites, they plot on this line here. Here you see the ordinary chondrites, they plot on this graph. Here you see, for example, the Earth is that, the moon is that, and the sun is much below. And we still do not understand why there is so much variation of oxygen isotopes in the solar system. It is still a mystery. We can discuss about that, but something clearly has changed the isotopic composition of the solar system during its formation. And today we see that most of solar system objects has completely different isotopic composition. There is only one exception to that, and it is a very important and significant exception. Only the Earth and the Moon has very close or almost exactly the same oxygen isotopic composition. Here you see the Earth, okay? Here you see the Moon. They lie on this blue line here. And basically what this tells you is that when they are on the same line, it means they are derived exactly from the same reservoir of materials. So this is remarkable because there are no objects in the solar system we know with the same isotopic signature as the Earth in oxygen. And what it seems, what you want to say when you see that is that maybe, in fact, the moon is made of Earth material. Okay. So all that element seems to draw quite a clear picture, but in fact, you will see that there are inconsistencies. When you put all things together, you have the idea that the moon could be made of heated moon material, okay? And it seems that all that could be more or less explained in the idea of a giant impact, okay? So it is why today the standard theory of moon formation relies on the scenario of a giant impact. And this idea comes very naturally when you study solar system formation. Why is it natural to expect giant impacts during the solar system formation? So I remind you very briefly the scenario of solar system formation. So first, there is a collapse of a molecular cloud and you form a protostar with a disk that is made of gas and grains in solar composition. Then the grains sedimentate in the disk midplane. And then after some process, the grains, they assemble in bodies that are called planetesimals, okay, that are more or less the parent bodies of planetary embryo. And then after you planetesimals, they grow by process called pebble accretion of collisions. And in a few million years, you may form planetary embryos in the inner solar system and giant planets and fully formed giant planets in the outer solar system. Then after the gas disk dissipates and you are left with a proto-solar system in which that is populated with hundreds of planetary embryos in the inner solar system. So in this simulation by Sean Ramon in 2004, you see here the semi-major axis on eccentricity of, this is an n-body simulation of accretion. You see about 100 planetary embryos. And the color stands for the amount of water. And then after, as time increases, starting point, 1 million years, 10, 30, 100 million years, you see that the population of embryos grow in size, okay? And also the embryos are excited by the giant planet and they collide. And as they collide, they stick together. And why do they stick together? Simply because they are big. They have high escape velocities. When you have two protoplanets colliding, most of times the result is an accretion or a fusion of the protoplanet. Okay. And in about a few hundred million years, you end up with, let's say, 3 to 5 planets in the solar system like that. During this period, if you look at the type of collision, it is in general collision at about typically the escape velocity of the order of 5 to 20 kilometers per second. So it is very natural to expect today during the formation of the solar system that you have a long phase that may have lasted typically 100 million years during which planetary embryos have suffered giant collisions. So following this idea, the standard idea today is that maybe the moon was formed after the last giant impact that happened on Earth. So this has been extensively studied in the year 2000. There are still a lot of work on that. I will show you a hydrodynamical simulation of such an impact. So here the color stands for the temperature. So I will show you what is called the canonical scenario. So what is the canonical scenario? The idea is that here you have the proto-Earth, here you have the impactor. And if you want to conserve angular momentum, okay, if you want to make a moon, an Earth-moon system with the same angular momentum as today, and this is a very strong constraint, you do not have much choice, in fact, on the mass on the impactor and the angle of impact, okay? And so the canonical scenario, it is a proto-Earth that is heated by a body that has about the size of Mars. And let me show you a simulation. So here you see, the impactor is entirely destroyed, okay? The Earth is completely melted during the impact. And you do not see it here, okay, but the core of the impactor goes to the core of the Earth. And you end up with a heated proto-Earth that is surrounded by a debris disk. Okay, And the resulting temperature, alors it depends on simulation, on the equation of state, but the resulting temperature at the surface is typically 3,000 to 7,000 kelvins, depending on the impact geometry and on the simulation. And what is important to understand is that in this canonical scenario, it is assumed that the angular momentum just of the system just after the giant impact is the same as today. So the angular momentum is considered as a fossil information about the Earth-Moon system just after the last giant impact. Okay, let's move to the next slide. Here is another animation where now the temperature scale is clearly plotted. So you see it's very hot at the location of impacts. You see there is a tidal arm, okay. And that's it, okay. And you end up with the body, which in that case, you see the temperature is about 700 to 800 Kelvin. So it's a very hot event. Okay, so what is also important to notice is that you have formed a debris disk. But when you see the simulation, you see, okay, it's clear, we have a very hot event and the moon will form in the debris disk. Why not? It is true. But if you really look at those SPH simulations that are very popular, there is still something that is missing, is that you never see the formation of the moons in those SPH simulations. Simulation of giant impacts never form the moon. Alors, why? Why do you never see simulation? Why do you never see the formation of the moon in the simulation of a giant impact? It is simply because simulation of giant impacts, in general, most of them do not have radiative transfer. So, and you assume in general adiabatic equation of state. Okay. So it means that you are limited to very short time scale. The simulation can give you only, I would say, realistic results on time scales, on dynamical size, on dynamical time scales. That is typically about a few hours. Okay. All simulations that I've shown you typically extend on, let's say, 10 or 20 hours after the moment of impact. Okay. And since there is no cooling physics in those simulations, okay, in fact, the system never cools down to the point where the material can collapse dense enough to form the moon. So what tells those simulations? They tell you that you form a debris disk, and then after you have to stop the simulation. And what you want to know, what people have worked a lot, I would say in the last 10 years, is to understand how to form the moon from this debris disk. And this debris disk, you will see, is very, very exotic compared to what we are used to study in astrophysics, okay? And I will try to explain you the physics of this disk, and you will see it is still very mysterious, okay? So the idea today is that after the giant impact, you form this debris disk, and this debris disk is mostly made of volatilized rock material. So in fact, it is a magma disk. And if you compute the temperature and pressure in this disk, what you find is that the mass, most of the mass of the disk is in liquid form. So compared to everything what I know in astrophysics, this is a very strange disk because it is a liquid disk that is made of magma that is orbiting the Earth. And now I'm going to try to understand, to try to discuss the physics of this disk in which we do think that the moon has formed. Okay, so I will first show you the first attempt to understand the physics of this debris disk. Alors, let's abandon the term of debris disk because in astrophysics, debris disk is really a term that is devoted to dusty disks around protostars, okay? So the technical term is a proto-lunar disk. So now I use the word a proto-lunar disk. So what is the physics of this proto-lunar disk? So first I will show you a first attempt to study the evolution of the proto-lunar disk. Here is a simulation by Takeda and Ida 2001. So they have put, I would say it is a hard sphere simulation. So you put hundreds of thousands of hard spheres and around the Earth. So it is seen from above on the right scale. And here it is seen edge on. And here you see the Earth. Okay. So if you look at the disk edge on, so first you have a big donut around the Earth. And the hard spheres, they collide, they lose energy, and you see that the disk collapse into a thin disk after typically 30 orbits typically. Now, if you look at the same simulation, but face on the right, what you see is that here you have the Earth, here you have the protolunar disk. You see that very close to the Earth, you see that the protolunar disk is completely homogeneous. But a little bit further, you see that you have spiral arms exactly like in a galaxy. Why do you have spiral arms? Simply because the disk becomes gravitationally unstable. When a disk becomes very dense, it makes spiral arms like in a galaxy. And you see those spiral arms. And interestingly, here, do you see this circle here? This circle is called the Roche limit, the Roche limit. So it's typically 3 to 4 Earth radii, the Roche limit. And the Roche limit, it is this theoretical limit under which the material cannot form a single aggregate, but beyond which, beyond the Roche limit, aggregates can form protosatellites. And it's very interesting because in this simulation, you see that you form singular aggregates just beyond the Roche limit, as you see here. So inside, there is no aggregate. You have spiral arms. But beyond the Roche limit, there is no disk anymore. And you have more like a collection of aggregates. So it tells you that maybe the best place to form the moon, it is at the Roche limit, typically at 3 Earth radii. And maybe the moon form in this so-called protolunar disk. And here is a higher resolution simulation. You see the Earth, you see the Roche limit, and here you see the forming aggregates. Okay. And this situation is really remindful of something that we have seen with the Cassini mission. So let's go just for a slide to Saturn. You know that Saturn has beautiful rings. And here you have more or less a similar physics. Okay. You have some similarities. This is Saturn. The Roche limit is typically located here around the F ring. And we are about 2.5 Saturn radii. And below the Roche limit, you have a disk because Saturn's tides prevent any accretion of aggregates. But beyond the Roche limit, you do not have rings anymore, or you can have dusty rings that have a slightly different physics. But you are dominated by satellites, okay? And at the Roche limit itself, you have a population of satellites that are in a kind of transient state between a ring state, I would say, and a satellite state. So inspired by what we know on Saturn, in the year 2000, there are several works that said, okay, maybe we understand the moon formation. There is a giant impact. You create a dense protolunar disk, and this protolunar disk becomes gravitationally unstable, and you form the moon at the Roche limit. Nice. Okay, and when you look at the time scale of formation of the moon, you see the mass of the aggregates as a function of time, and typically the moon forms in 100 orbits, and 100 orbits at 3 Earth radii, it's only 3 weeks. And so it was a very strange result because people say, what do you mean? You mean that the moon formed in 3 weeks only after the giant impact? Okay, it looked a very short time scale, a very surprising time scale. But this is not the end of the story by far, because a very important physics is missing in those hard sphere models that were popular in year 2000. Okay. Thermodynamics was completely absent of those models. There is no notion of radiative transfer. There is no notion of phase transition. there is no notion of viscous heating. It is a very idealized models of disk. And in hard-sphere disk, most of the energy is contained in the gravitational energy. But if you really compute, if you compare the thermal energy of the protolunar disk compared to its gravitational energy, what you find is just after the giant impact, the disk is completely dominated by its internal and thermal energy. It is now a much more better vision of this disk that is more as we understand it today. So we think that after the giant impact, the proto-Earth is completely molten. So the proto-Earth must be surrounded by a kind of mineral atmosphere. And the proto-lunar disk here should be like that. It may be completely liquid in the mid-plane. It is made of lava, if you want. It's called magma, rocky magma, at temperature larger than 2000 K, okay? And it must be surrounded by a kind of mineral atmosphere that radiates away the system, okay? So it's a liquid disk, it's a physics we do not know very well because it's an incompressible system, okay? And so it needs devoted tools to be studied. And if now you try to understand how long it takes to cool the disk, you can do like an order of magnitude calculation. It may take about 100 to 1,000 years. So maybe the time scale to form the moon is maybe 1,000 years plus 3 weeks. Okay. So now let's go now more in details to see what are the predictions of those simulations. First, the first problems in this beautiful picture happened more or less in 2010, where when people really try to investigate with precision what is the material that goes into the moon. And what they found was very disturbing, in fact. What they found is that the material that goes to the moon, the vast majority of material that goes to the moon, it is not Earth material. In fact, it is impactor material, you know, by a very large amount. And so it is a problem because, as I told you, the composition of the moon, in fact, is very similar to the Earth. And we do not understand how it is possible that the composition of the moon is so close to the Earth's composition, whereas SPH simulations tells you that the composition of the moons should be mostly made of impactor material. Now, there is one possibility, of course, is to say that the impactor has had a composition very close to the Earth. That is always possible. Maybe the impactor has formed close to the Earth's environment, so maybe it's formed more or less the same material. But there is really a problem with the oxygen isotopic composition of the moon. The oxygen isotopic composition of the moon is almost not distinguishable from the one of the Earth. So it's very hard to imagine how you could form two bodies in the solar system with so close oxygen isotopic composition. So here there is first a mystery. So there is a problem is that most of the material that goes into the moon is not Earth material. It is mostly impactor material. So here there is something to understand. So to overcome this problem, it has been suggested that maybe during the disk phase, you had a lot of mixing, which is always possible. Maybe the proto-Earth equilibrated with the proto-lunar disk, so that if they had different oxygen isotopic composition, there was a strong homogenization, okay? And then after, you couldn't, then maybe everything finished with the same composition. It has been studied by those people who suggested homogenization. Alors, the thing is that they found coefficient of diffusion that may do the job, okay? The only problem is that we do not really understand what is the source of diffusion. It must be molecular diffusion cannot do the job. It must be turbulent diffusion, okay? The only problem is that this level of turbulence that is needed is so big, okay? and it must last for 100 to 1,000 years, and we do not understand the source of turbulence, okay? And so here there is a problem. So there was this big crisis in the year 2010, and it was called the angular momentum crisis, okay? So how to solve the problem? So then after, there was an important paper by two American colleagues, Chuck and Stewart, that said, okay, the problem we have with the previous model, the canonical model, is that we assume that the impactor was impacting at the escape velocity of Earth with some angle and with some size. And the main constraint on the canonical model was to reproduce the 2D angular momentum of the solar system. And they say, but and what if we forget this constraint? And what if the angular momentum of the Earth-Moon system was much bigger than today? Okay. And so they have designed a scenario that is very interesting when the Earth was rotating much faster than in the canonical scenario in 2 hours compared to 4 hours in the canonical scenario. So the proto-Earth is very, very close to centrifugal explosion, I would say. And then it is impacted at a very high speed, at 20 kilometers per second, by a small impactor. Okay. And here is a simulation. So you see, so the Earth is destroyed. And you see, again, a formation of a debris disk. And in gray, you have the Roche limit. Okay. Alors, why is it interesting? Because in that case, when the impactor impacts the Earth, it spins up the Earth. And then since the Earth becomes centrifugally unstable, and so the Earth, I would say, explodes more or less, thanks to the centrifugal force. And thanks to the centrifugal force, it turns out that most of the material that you put in orbit in the protolunar disk, in that case, is Earth material. So in that case, you solve the problem of the moon composition because in that case, you get Earth material in orbit rather than impactor material. And so this is what is obtained in a simulation. You see that most of the protolunar disk is made of Earth material. Then after, the problem is that you have too much angular momentum. Then after, you have to find a nice explanation to explain the 2D angular momentum of the Earth-Moon system. And so it has been suggested that, alors, I will not go into the details, but basically the idea is that during the evolution of the moon, at some point, there was maybe a resonance with the sun called an evection resonance. It is when the precession rate of the moon becomes commensurable with the orbital period of the Earth around the Sun. And in that case, what you have is that the Sun takes angular momentum from the Earth-Moon system, okay? And depending on the different assumption, you can pump most of the Earth-Moon system angular momentum and go back to the 2D value. The only problem is that it's still a speculative model and the physical model that is used here is a matter of debate. So I would say it's a very interesting idea, but by far it is not, there is no consensus on that for the moment, okay. So here I would like just to remind you that this idea that the Earth explodes to put its own material in orbit, in fact, is not new. It's a kind of a new version of the original scenario of moon formation that has been proposed by the end of the 19th century by the son of Richard Darwin. It is George Darwin, that was an astronomer and that was president of the Royal Astronomical Society, that proposed at this time that the Earth was spinning so fast that the material of the Pacific Ocean went to space. At this time, we did not know the continent, the moving of the continent, okay? And this is a kind of new version of that. Alors, is it the end of the story? Do we have solved the origin of the moon? Well, in fact, the only problem is that when you go into the details, there are still a lot of problems. In that case, the impact is so energetic that You do not really get the debris disk after the impact. When you really you look at the simulation, what you have is that you see that most of the material is not in liquid form. It is completely vaporized. Okay. And after the impact, you get a kind of a transient state that has been called a synestia, where you have the fully molten earth rotating like a rigid body here, and you have a continuous material, and it is surrounded by a donut of mineral gas at temperature in the range of about 10,000 K. Okay. And so the idea is that this kind of big donut, okay, will cool down and maybe form the moon. But the physics of this synestia thing is really not understood because it's a new astrophysical object, okay, and it is still under investigation. And in particular, it seems that some work has maybe succeeded to form a moon in that. But the only problem is that it is so hot, about 10,000 K, that you do not isotopic fractionation, is that all isotopes are completely homogenized. And so there will be no difference at all between the isotope on Earth and isotopes on the moon, because homogenization is much too strong. Okay, so you see that, in fact, the question of the origin of the moon, it is still a very big matter of debate. We still do not understand precisely what is the context of formation of the moon. And to finish, because it's already 47, I just would like to draw, I will jump some slide, hein, okay? I will just try to draw your attention to a new range of models that has been developed recently. By myself, but also by other colleagues, okay, where we try to investigate a kind of different way to explain the origin of the material composition, and that is a little bit inspired from what we see on exoplanets, in particular from what is called lava planets. So in this kind of model, maybe the moon did not get its isotopic and its final isotopic and atomic composition just after the giant impact. Maybe you form a proto moon, okay? Maybe you form a proto moon with more or less the same composition as the Earth, but maybe something happened when the moon was fully covered by a magma ocean. So we are a little bit later in the history of the moon. And we assume that the moon was a kind of lava planet, okay, orbiting very close to the Earth. And we have studied what happened to the magma ocean at the surface of the proto moon. And we found interesting things, okay. First, if you have a magma ocean, okay, you have vaporization, so there should be a kind of outgas atmosphere. And there is something very interesting, because when the moon is very close to the Earth, it is affected by the Earth tides. And the Earth tides, in fact, make the escape of gas very easy, okay? When you have an exoplanet, for example, that is very close to its star, okay? Its atmospheres can overflow its Roche lobe, and you can lose atmosphere through the Lagrange point. And we have studied that with the proto-moon, and we found that if there was a very hot atmosphere around the moon, the material would leave the moon by the Lagrange point and will be put in orbit around the Earth. So it was first suggested that maybe all the missing material, all the volatile material, maybe has not been lost for the Earth-Moon system, but maybe of this material went back to the Earth or was lost in space, okay. And then we have tried to understand how is it possible from the gas to leave the moon surface. Alors, it's a kind of hydrodynamical escape. So you know, for exoplanet, you have two kinds of atmospheric escape. You have what is called the Jeans escape. Jeans escape, it is more or less, it's a kind of evaporation process. It is the fraction of atoms that goes larger than the escape velocity can leave the planet. We know there is a Jeans escape on the Earth, on Venus, on Mars also, okay. But you have a stronger effect that is called the hydrodynamical escape. It is when you have either a very hot atmosphere. So it is when the pressure gradient exceeds the gravity acceleration. So it's a kind of atmospheric explosion because of too strong pressure gradient, okay, first case. And the second case, it is when you have a strong irradiation and when you heat up the atmosphere. And for the case of the moon, it is very possible that when it formed, it was very hot. So we have computed the equation of hydrodynamics, okay? So you remember, here this is a conservation of mass and conservation of momentum. And what we do find is that it is not possible for the moon to have a stable atmosphere when it is hot. What we do find is that here it is the distance to the moon, and here it is the velocity of the atmosphere. No hydrostatic atmosphere is possible on the proto-moon. If it has an atmosphere, the gas goes away very rapidly. It goes away even at supersonic speed. It is called the Parker wind, okay. And it is a hydrodynamical escape. And during this process, what we find is that you lose most of the volatile species. And you lose most of the volatile species. And as the moon goes away from the Earth, so we have computed the flux of material going away as a function of the Earth-Moon distance. And what we find is that when the moon is cold, the flux is very low. But when the moon is hot here, the flux is very big. Okay. But what you see is that this flux drops as the moon goes away from the Earth. So I will not go much in details, but the take-home message is that if you take a moon at about 100,000 K, you can maybe explain at least the sodium and potassium abundance on the moon. And I will conclude on that, is that we propose here that maybe the moon has degassed more or less like a lava exoplanet when it was young, okay? And at temperatures that are not so high, and at least for sodium and potassium, it seems to do the job. And now we are trying to see if it's possible to explain other elements. So in conclusion, there is no consensus on really how the moon formed. Clearly, it seems that giant impact was the key. And it seems also that there was at some point a proto-lunar disk. Okay. But for the moment, there is no model that can reconcile the composition of the moon, the angular momentum of the moon, okay, and the isotopic composition of the moon. In general, when you get two aspects, you always miss the third, okay, depending on your model. Okay. The main problem is that this proto-lunar disk has a very complex physics. Okay, it's a liquid in orbit around a planet, and which physics is for the moment not well described. Okay, and it needs development of new tools because it's an incompressible fluid in equilibrium with an atmosphere, and radiative transfer is really a key aspect because at the beginning most of the energy is in form of thermal internal energy. Okay, so there is a lot of theoretical development. Okay, and an alternative scenario was to say that if the moon formed with the same as the Earth's composition, maybe it suffered intense hydrodynamical escape, like some exoplanets, and that's it. So just to finish, it put forward, I think, the importance also of magma ocean when the protoplanet formed, and maybe the moon is a really key to understand the physics of Earth formation and the physics of magma ocean. And I have finished. Sorry, I was a little bit long, and I thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sébastien, for your seminar. Is there any question or comment for Sébastien in the audience? I can start with one, Sébastien. You shown us that there is no consensus on the formation of the moon. Is there better consensus for other satellites in the solar system for the formation of other satellites?
Well, in fact, the thing that I would say that the formation of other satellites, I mean, there is a limited range of models that are invoked, but more or less the formation of, there is a different scenario more or less for all planets of the solar system. So for the moon, there is this idea of a giant impact, but we do not know about what giant impact confer the seminar. For Mars, we do not know if Phobos and Deimos are captured, okay, or if it's a giant impact. For Jupiter, there are two models. There is one, for Jupiter, people mostly think that they form a circumplanetary disk, a little bit like the satellites of the, like planets. So I would say that Jupiter, there is quite a consensus that it forms a circumplanetary disk. And for Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune, it's not clear. Some people think it comes from a circumplanetary disk. Some other people say that it comes from the rings. Okay. And for the moment, all models are competing. But it seems that, in fact, maybe there are different ways to form satellites. Maybe you have, like, maybe you have also different ways to form planets. And all those models are still fighting. Okay.
Okay, thanks. Michel Denfeld?
Yes, good morning. Thanks for a very enlightening talk. But all this hypothesis is based on the fact that the return sample from the Apollo missions have all the same composition. And now I have seen in the last year some controversy saying that, in fact, these Apollo samples, although the landing sites were quite different, but they were relatively close to each other, and they may have sampled surface material, which was in fact simply debris from a single big impact on the moon, and are therefore not representative of the whole moon composition. What is the situation with that?
Well, that is a very good point, in fact. You have always this question, but that you have with any sample. Huh? What is the representativity of the sample? To what extent the sample you have really represent, give you a global view of the object? Now, it is true that for some samples, there is strong concern that maybe they come really from ejected material from the same region. But still, we do see a range of age because we measure different age. Okay, so and we do see that all moon samples are not concentrated on the same age. So they must date different events, okay? And there is, and we do see that the older samples, okay, correspond to this anorthosite material that that I have talked about, okay? But the only problem is that we only sample the face visible, the face of the moon pointing toward Earth, okay? And what would be very, very interesting would be now to have sample of the dark side of the moon, okay, like in Pink Floyd, and to see if they are really like the same. And for the moment, we do not know, okay. And we all do the hypothesis that the moon was fully molten when it's formed, but in fact, we do not really know. Yeah. So I agree with your point. It's an important point. And if we have new samples that show us a larger diversity, maybe it will make us revise the scenario.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Gary Mamon, a question?
Okay, thank you, Sébastien. That was indeed very enlightening, as Michel said, new physics for me. So I wonder why the simulation showed that the tidal debris can condense into structures like moons, and in fact some of the simulation showed more than one. So why is it that the Earth has only one moon? Why is it that so I was going to ask why is it that Jupiter has many, but you said that there are different theories for Jupiter and for the Earth. And can we use that as a constraint? The fact that we only have one moon, can that tell us something about the formation mechanism?
That's a good point. Okay, in the simulation, you see the formation of different debris. Okay, there are some other simulations I did not show, but simulation by Robin Canup, that is an American researcher, that have explored that in more details. And what she finds is that even though you form several aggregates close to the Roche limit, as they go away due to tidal interaction with the Earth, they tend to form, they all collide and form one single object. And he tells you something, and it is indeed a constraint, because in fact, you have two time scales to consider. You have one time scale, it is the time scale of orbital expansion, okay? And you have another time scale, it is the production rate of new aggregates. And so when orbital expansion is very fast and production rate of new aggregates is very slow, then you tend with many, many moons. And this is what we find, for example, for Saturn, for Uranus and Neptune, okay, where the moon goes away very rapidly, much on a time scale that is much shorter than the formation time scale. But in the case of the moon, in fact, the orbital expansion is quite low compared to the production rate of new aggregates. And in that case, you form a lot of new aggregates that goes away very slowly, okay. And when you form a lot of new aggregates at the same place that goes away very slowly, in general, they all collide and form one single object. Yeah. So we are more in this regime. Am I clear?
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. Jean-François Cardozo, you have a question?
Hello. Very naive question. Are you saying in the scenario of this giant impact that it implies that all the internal thermal energy on the Earth today is still the result of this big kinetic energy due to the collision?
No, I'm not implying that. Today, the Earth's thermal budget mainly comes from heating of long-lived radioactive elements. Okay, all this thermal energy that I have shown you typically goes away, I would say. Alors, I don't know the number for the proto-Earth, but for the disk, I can tell you that for the disk, it should cool down at most in 10,000 years. Okay. So maybe it's one or two order of magnitude larger for the proto-Earth. Okay. But today, the thermal budget of the Earth has completely forgotten this event.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jean-François Lestrade.
Yes, thank you for your very comprehensive and enthusiastic presentation. I would like to ask you about the debris which are within the Roche lobe in the impactor mechanisms. What are their fate, and should we expect still some of the biggest pieces to be to have not cleaned up over the time scale of the Earth's life?
Alors, this is a very good question. And what I can tell you is that for the moment, all simulation all studies that are trying to simulate this proto-lunar disk, they never end up with an empty disk. You always have material that is still orbiting in the disk. So here I would say there is a question, or there is a problem. How do you, because today there is no debris disk on the Earth, it is obvious, okay? But by what process you remove all metal of the proto-lunar disk is not clear. What is clear? It is, I would say, more or less 50% of the mass will fall onto the Earth because it is an accretion disk. So more or less 50% of the mass will fall down into the Earth. And the other 50% will be digested into the moon. Okay. But if you still have 1% or 0.1% of the disk left, okay, the disk is very massive. Hein? It is a few moon masses. Hein? It's about a moon masses typically, hein? One or two moon masses. It's still a lot of material. Okay. And for the moment, no study has ever been able to completely clean up the disk. And it puts forward another question where there is no good answer today. Why don't we have rings around terrestrial planets? Everybody agrees to say that giant impacts is really the common scenario of the end of formation of all terrestrial planets. And it's very natural to think that in giant impacts, you form debris disk. Okay, but today, as you know, like me, there is no debris disk or no rings around terrestrial planets. And why is that is not clear. Alors, one argument is to say that maybe a solar wind or solar radiation would blow away all dust, okay? Now you can do that with very small particles, but as far as we understand, you should have big particles in those disks that should survive to solar wind or solar radiation, okay? Enfin, radiation pressure. When I say solar radiation, I mean exactly radiation pressure, okay? And we don't know.
Okay, thank you, Sebastian.
Thank you, and maybe a last question by Nicolas Pranzos.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for this nice talk. My question is perhaps related to the one of Gary. I've heard that the ratio, the mass ratio of Moon to the Earth is quite high with respect to the other planets of the solar system. Do we understand this mass ratio? Is it easy in simulations to reproduce such a mass for the Moon?
The mass ratio of the Moon. The Moon is 1% of the Earth. Okay. Alors, it is very big. The biggest mass ratio is for Pluto. Alors, well, I know Pluto is not a planet, okay, whatever. But the mass ratio for the Pluton 40 system is 10%. Okay. So, I would say solid planets or terrestrial planets, it does not seem too difficult to have such a mass ratio. Okay. Because you see, for example, to have such a mass ratio, the impactor must be typically a Mars-sized object impacting on an Earth-sized object. And in current theories of terrestrial planet formation, this is, I would say, standard mass ratio between the impactor, between the two objects. So it is very common. Now, if you compare to the giant planet, the situation is completely different. In giant planet, interestingly, the mass ratio of all the satellites compared to the giant planets is about the same for the four giant planets. It is about 10 to the minus 4. Okay, and that we do not understand. That we do not understand. Why is the mass ratio of the satellites of the giant planets compared to the planet more or less the same for all the four giant planets? We do not understand. Alors, there was some attempt on explanation. There was some work that say that maybe it was related to the physics of circumplanetary disks forming around giant planets. Where you can do complex calculation, you imply some turbulence, the speed of the dust in circumplanetary disk, and at the end, in some case, you can explain why you have always 10 to the minus 4, and it comes from the turbulence in circumplanetary disk. The only problem is that today, we do think that maybe most of the giant planet satellites were not formed in a circumplanetary disk. For example, for Uranus, that has a very strong tilt. They invoked a giant impact. So to conclude, this constant ratio of the satellite for the giant planets for the moment has no clear explanation. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I think there are no more questions. So thank you again, Sébastien. And so we'll be back next Friday for the last IAP seminar before the summer break, and hopefully in September we'll be back in our amphitheater for a presential seminar at IAP. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye bye.